Okay, I got my thumbs up. We're back. Sorry about that. I didn't want you guys to have a fuzzy video, okay? We are back. I would rather you have quality so that you can see it. Oh, y'all came back in fast. Good, good, good. Thank you, Keela. That's why I was asking last time. Go share the video. Good morning, good morning. Earlier, we were talking a little bit about having a humor with God. Okay, good, Marianne. Crystal clear. And I was just sitting here laughing. And I think sometimes we're a little bit too serious with God. Like, we come before God with all of this, Lord, you know. And God is like, I want y'all to have a relationship with me. Like, a relationship with me. The funny thing is, I don't know why when we come before God, we act like God doesn't see us daily. Like God doesn't see us daily. Or like God didn't uniquely design us the way that he designed us. God put every facet of your personality in place. Some of the things that are inside of us have been altered because of the circumstance and the situations we've been through. And I'm telling you this from such a personal place because for a while I had got so serious. Like, I had got so serious and people thought I was such a serious person. And I am. My personality is very focused, right? But I'm really goofy. That's why when I run into people, like when I run into people out in public and they're like, I watch you on Coffee and Conversations, and I'm like, you do? And then they have this look in this in their face. I don't know if they think I'm about to preach to them or something. I always get tickled because they have this look in this face. And I'm like, I promise you I'm not about to preach, but I will hug you. I love to hug. I have a supernatural hug. I'm like, I will hug you, but I promise you not about to get no CNC sermon right now. I promise you about to get no sermon right now. I'm gonna hug you, I'm gonna compliment you, and then we're gonna keep moving. We keep moving in this thing. Sometimes I get tickled because I run into people and it's like, I don't know if they looking for a prophetic word, but when I'm down, unless the Lord says something to me, I'm right in my element. My crew knows that I love music and to play. And oh yeah, Marianne, you know I love the hug. Like, I think God has blessed me with a supernatural hug. And I know that sounds funny, but I'm really serious about that. Like, there's something in my hugs, and they have love in it. Anytime somebody's having a bad day, I really want to get to them and just give them a hug. Like, I think there's something supernatural in my hugs. Oh, thank you for that. Gloria says, someone told me that I'm too silly because I love to laugh and talk about God and the joy of the Lord. That's because they're too serious. And people have been religiously taught that the Lord is one way. And the reason that, and since they've been religiously taught that the Lord is one way, they only expect him. That's good. They only expect him in one way. So they can't really receive God in the fullness of who he is. Right? Because they're looking for him to be one way because that's how they've been religiously taught over the years. So instead of coming before the Lord and having a conversation, that's what prayer is, a dialogue with God. People come before the Lord and they're like, Heavenly Father, come into my presence now. You know, and there's nothing wrong with religion, with religion. I'm not saying that. I'm not trying to knock your traditions. There's nothing wrong with traditions. But if we're really going to enter into this relationship with God, a relationship with him, we have to understand the funny side, the humor of God and who he is. I am cool, Whitney Litzy. Thank you. So, good morning. Welcome to Coffee and Conversations. I am your host for today, Lakeisha Johnson. That's what I feel like I should say every morning. Go and share the video live right now. We were just talking about the humor of God, if you're just logging in, the funny side of God, how God desires to have a relationship with us that doesn't look all downtrodden and sad and all of those things. God put humor in us for a reason. If you have a sense of humor, it's in you for a reason. If you have light and love, it's in you for a reason. And God meant for us and designed us to partake of all of those things, I'm telling you. And so when I run into people and they're all serious in church, I play in church. I listen to the word, but I play. When I run into people and they're all serious in church, man, it's a setup for me to get a joke in somewhere, because I'm not saying you shouldn't be focused, but if you're in church like this, like, you're going to miss the shift in the atmosphere because you're so stoic. And then you don't understand that your praise unto God is your individual praise unto God. And you're missing the opportunity for the fellowship and the relationship. They partied. Jesus still partied. They had parties. They had celebrations. They had moments. I mean, man, the presence of the Lord is just amazing. Like, I've been before the Lord and just bust out laughing before because of the things that he was showing me in the spirit. So I want you to get a new revelation of what your relationship with God looks like as we're making this transition in our lives, and stop putting God in this box that you live in. You live in that box. God doesn't live in that box. He doesn't live in that box that you created for yourself. That's your box that you live in. God is so outside the box, and he's so ready to demonstrate and share and show himself to you like never before. Like, he's so ready to do it, but most of us are missing him because we've decided to leave him in this box. And in this box, we're missing the opportunities to fellowship. We're missing the opportunities to minister. We're missing the opportunities to share the word of God. We're missing the opportunities to be effective. You're asking the Lord, you're saying to the Lord, look, Lord, use me. Use me like never before. Like, use me at the capacity. And God is like, cool, I want to use you. And then he sets you in a place to be used. And you're like, no, I don't want to be used like that. Like, I don't want to be used like that. Like when you clap and people turn to look, I'm like, well, Niecy, my rhythm lacks sometimes. I get off beat. Anyway, but use me. And God is trying to use you outside your box. He's trying to set you in a different place. We're not going to all be on this pulpit and in this platform. Some of us are going to be on some one-on-one circumstances and situations in which he wants to use us. Some of us are going to be used in a hair bow business. Some of us are going to be used in a photography business. Whatever your sphere of influence is where God is going to use you. But if you feel like you can only be used in this box, right? If you feel like you can only be used in a box, I have a friend who's an amazing referee. Like, he's an amazing referee. And I've heard people talk about him all the time. Like, I've heard people talk about him. I've heard people talk about his reffing skills, what his character, his integrity, and he's real serious. But in his reffing, it comes off as effective, and kids are drawn to him, and adults are drawn to him, and people are drawn to him. And so he has favor in his reffing. And the reason he has favor in his reffing, because that's a sphere of influence for him to be effective. And somebody's like, in reffing? Like, in reffing? God's going to use you to be effective in reffing? Yep, God can use you to be effective in makeup. My MUA, Cassandra Hill, is amazing, right? I don't know why we went here, but it's necessary, because this is what I was going to start in. My makeup, my MUA, is amazing. She's effective. When she's doing my makeup, it's actually ministry to me. She takes her time with me. Her hands are on me, and she's ministering to my spirit. Like, she's ministering to my spirit, and she's making my face up, and she's creating this thing, and she's very serious about her creation. And I'm usually sharing something with her, but as much as I am sharing something with her, listen to this, as much as I'm sharing something with her, she's pouring into me. She doesn't even realize to it's a downtime for me. She's like, oh my gosh, she's building me up with her words. She's utilizing me at this moment. And it's like, my God, when I leave her, I feel refreshed and my face is beat. But she's ministered to me in her area of influence by just tapping in and capturing whatever I need to capture for that moment. So we're not going to leave God in this box. We're going to take him outside the box. And once we get him outside the box, that's where we're going to encounter him. That's where we're going to experience him. That's where our influence is. A lot of you have been missing. And I'm going to put my girl Roz Warren out there a little bit. A lot of you have been missing some things because you can't. My girl Roz Warren can style anything on a budget. That's a gift. That's a gift. That's a gift. Like, that's a gift she has. And I can't wait till Roz's closet comes alive and she has this Style Your Life and can teach women to do this. But if we're all efficient, had a love that, but it's because a lot of us, Niecy, miss our gifts. We miss our gift. We don't understand that thing, that knack is a gift, adds to the kingdom. See, we think it's all going to look in one way. It's not just about the pulpit. Roz can sing, Roz can preach, but her intimate moments with women are going to come when she teaches them how to style their life on a budget. That's going to be an amazing thing for her. That's going to be an amazing thing for her. So I'm just explaining, I'm saying to you, that is how God uses our gifts to go to another level. If you haven't shared the video, share the video right now. And we're looking for him in this box. And God is saying, get your butt out that box and come encounter me and come experience me. And come and allow me, wow, yep, that's it. When we don't see those things as ministry, we minimize them. Come and allow me to show you what ministry looks like for you. It's not what everybody else said. It's not what everybody else said. I guess the Holy Spirit needed us to go in this direction today. Let me pray. Father God, we thank you that we bless the word today, bless the people. Let it not fall on deaf ears. Let it be implanted in our hearts, Lord God. Father God, so that they just receive this and it multiplied the kingdom for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. We got started, didn't we? We got started. And so it's we got to get out. We got to come out the box. We got to come out from this out the box mentality. We got to have an out the box mentality. When I started my consulting business, it was called Yo Girl Incorporated. Right? And Yo Girl Incorporated was so that I could help you break out the box and break into your destiny. Like, I'm trying to break you out the box and break you into destiny. And some of you just need a little help, right? You need a little help because you don't understand how to connect these dots so that the Lord can give you what you need for this next level. There was a question asked yesterday. And Genesis 15 and 1, I'm going to give you this little part. It says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your exceedingly reward. And yesterday, somebody asked the question, how do I know it's from God? And a lot of times we miss an experience with God because people have told us God only comes to us one way, right? God only comes to us one way. And I'm going to tell you for a fact, I know that God can come in personal appearance. He can come in an audible voice. He can come in dreams. He can come in ministering angels. The Spirit of God can come upon your mind. And then he can also make the scripture alive in your heart. Those are the ways that God visits us. And I think it's essential for you to understand this in the next season, because the root work has been done. The Lord showed me that last night. He kept saying the root work has been done. Everybody that's been logging on, that's been doing the root work, that's been shifting, that's been reconciling, that's been putting everything into position, the root work has been done. Get set up now, because what he's about to do next is give you the instructions. He's about to give you the instructions for what needs to happen next. He's getting ready to tell you everything that you need to put in place. We've been doing the root work. We're looking at the selfish places in our heart. We've abandoned those before Christ. Now, here comes the instructions from the Lord. So if you're looking for how is the Lord going to visit me? How is the Lord going to talk to me? Where am I going to get this revelation from? It's going to come in your personal prayer time. It's going to come. And he might visit some of you. Some of you guys are going to have an increasing amount of dreams. Some of you guys are going to have some confirmation and encounters. People are going to start walking up to you, telling you what they see on you. Some of you guys are going to have just open visions. Like I'm telling you, for those of us that are tapped in, that's what's going to happen next. He's going to start giving you. You don't even have to be anxious. It says in Philippians, be anxious for nothing. Everything in prayer and supplication. Make your request known before God, and he's going to answer you. I'm telling you, he is. So what's going to happen next? You're going to have an increase in sensations. And for those of you that are new to this, I don't want you to be afraid. I don't want you to get worried or overwhelmed, because I want to tell you something. Satan is not going to set you up and give you dreams of anything good. He's not. He's fear. He's terror. He's not going to tell you to go bless somebody. He's not going to absolutely do any of that. That is not how he operates. So you don't have to question if you're having a dream or an overwhelming sensation to bless or to help someone. You're not going to have to sit around and question whether or not the decision that you're making is from God or Satan. Now, you do have to be careful on whether or not this is your voice or whether or not this is God's voice. But I'm telling you, that's how he's going to come. I'm telling you, confirmation is coming to you over the next few weeks. Specific instructions. That's all the Lord kept saying. You're going to get the instructions for absolutely everything you need. But I'm telling you, you got to get God out this box. So think it not strange when people start coming to you, and don't be looking. Don't run up to somebody. Do you have a word for me? Don't do that. God is going to design and bring absolutely everything he needs to bring to you in this next season. You just have to sit still. Get you a journal, right? And start writing this stuff down or logging this stuff in your phone. I had a dream that said this. In your scripture time, I'm telling you, in your scripture time, you're going to have very personal prayer time with God. You're going to have to pull away from some food. Some of y'all, God is going to set you into a fast. Isaiah 58, go to Isaiah 58 and read Isaiah 58. Some of you guys, he's going to set you in a fast, and he's calling you into this fast. This is not you calling you into the fast. The Lord is calling you into this fast. Some of you guys, he's going to call. It says, Isaiah 58 says, shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants. For day after day, they seek me out. And then God is going to call you into a fast. That's Isaiah 58. He's going to tell you when to fast, how long to fast, how much you need to fast, what you need to fast from. Everybody's fast doesn't look like everybody's fast. It's not, but you got to be willing to do the fast, because what the fast is going to do for you, it's going to break off the rest of the residue that comes from the old. That's what the fast is going to do. It's going to break off the rest of the residue that comes from the old. So he's going to call some of you into a fasting season, so that he can buffet your flesh and strengthen you, right? So that he can buffet your flesh and strengthen you in such a way, right, that you're prepared for this thing. So that's what you just need to know of what's coming next. That's the coming next. Now, I want to share something with some of you. As he begins to give you the vision and the line for what's happening next, I need a few of you to do me a favor. Don't jump ahead of God. Like, don't jump ship. Don't just jump out into this thing without getting the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding. The who, what, when, where, why, and how. Because can I tell you something? God is never going to tell you how to halfway do something. What keeps messing us up as Christians is we keep jumping out there. Oh, the Lord gave us a vision for something. We write it on Facebook. I ain't figured out why we do that yet. I don't write stuff. I don't write my vision. I'll prophesy over my vision, but I don't write what the Lord is telling me and just put it out there unless I already know He's giving me the wisdom, knowledge, and instruction for something. Can I tell you something? When God calls you to something and gives you the wisdom for something or gives you a knowledge, He calls you to a very secret place. He calls you to a secret place. And for some reason, we feel like whatever He's telling us is very public, and He doesn't. He calls us to a very secret place. When He started talking to Abraham in Genesis, right? When He started talking to him, He pulled him to an intimate place that was only just between him and God. That was it. That's why it says, "He who dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High." He called him to a very intimate space where it was just him and God. And you're like, and the reason why He called him to a secret place was He didn't want him confused by anybody else's voices. He wanted him to know this is a direct promise from me to you. And when God is giving you a promise or a vision for you, He's gonna pull you into a secret place. Yes, we talk out of season. I've done it myself. I talked about something too early and I wasn't supposed to. And so it's been on pause because my mouth moved too soon. And God was trying to show me the partners for it. He was trying to show me what to do with it. And He was trying to show me what needed to come next. So when God is giving you a vision, He'll call you to a very secret place. He's not going to do this. All this stuff doesn't have to be confirmed publicly. Now, will He call you out publicly? Yes. I've been in places and the prophecy has come upon me and I've been pulled out publicly. But I'm telling you that God is going to give you the information for you in a secret place, and the confirmation will come when it needs to. So you got to be prepared to be in your prayer time, to be in your prayer closet, and to be in your secret place so that you can receive the instructions of what you need next from the Lord. Now, what I want, I'm serious now. Do not go ahead of time. Like, don't jump out. Ask Him to who. Calm yourself down. We live in a society that teaches us, that doesn't teach us a lot of patience. So we want to move through everything quickly. I dropped something on my Instagram. If you're not on my Instagram, go follow LMJ Ministries on Instagram. Go follow Just Being LMJ. A lot of times I put a lot of encouragement out on my Instagram. I dropped something on Instagram and said, I know it's increasingly frustrating for you because you're waiting. But what I want you to do is continue to wait, because if God has called you something, I'm going to tell you something about the waiting game. In the wait is where your endurance is built, it's where your strength is built, and it's where He's preparing you for what's coming next. That's what's happening in the waiting game. If your desire is to be a wife and it seems like you're waiting, what's happening for you is you're being built in your strength and endurance so that you can become what you need to be. Being a wife or a husband is not for the faint at heart. So He's building your endurance up. He's building your endurance up so that you can be what you need to be in this season. You got to learn how to operate in patience. You got to learn how to be cool with what God says. You got to learn how not to be moved and move out. Be still. That's what Psalms 46 says. Be still and know that I'm God. You got to not move out, right? Ahead of time. Esther was prepared a full year before she came in the presence of the king. The Lord will let you know when you're ready to launch, when you're ready to move into a thing. The confirmation will come and it will flow differently when you allow the Lord to do it. Genesis 16, it says, now Sarai, Abraham's wife, had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abraham, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her. Abraham agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abraham had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar and she conceived. They created Ishmael because they launched out way too soon. Way too soon. Way ahead of God. Because in Sarah's head, we've waited absolutely long enough. I've waited too long. I'm not getting ready to sit here and wait on God no more. I know what God told me. I'm going to go ahead and do this on my own. Bump this. I'm going to do this on my own. Well, there was a promise to Sarah and Abraham. And because it wasn't happening in their time and their due season, she said, go on and sleep with my maid. And then they created Ishmael. God didn't put you in a season for you. Can I tell you something? If you were meant or you could do this on your own, God would have never spoken to you. He would just let you go do it on his own. Like, if you were meant to do this on your own, when God brings you to something and is saying, this is what I called you into be, it's unbelievable. Like, it's unbelievable. When God started giving me the vision for Coffee and Conversations, see, y'all think this is it. This is just a part of it. When he started giving me the vision for Coffee and Conversations, I was sitting here like this. When he started showing me the deep desires in my heart, I was overwhelmed. People, when I started saying it to some people that I could say it to, they thought that it was me saying it, but it was the desires that God deposited in my heart. It was bigger than what I could put my hands on. It needs more resources than I can create myself. Like, it needs nothing but God. And so Sarai, because she hasn't entered covenant with God yet, Sarai created Ishmael because she launched too soon. So I'm telling you, in this next set of instructions and what he's about to do, don't launch too soon. Do not get out before God. Let me tell you something. God has given me a wisdom for business. He's given me a wisdom for business. He's given me a wisdom for nonprofits, like how to properly set up a business, how to properly set up a nonprofit. Like, God has just given me a wisdom for such things. And I've watched people time and time again launch their business, launch their thing so prematurely because they're so anxious. And the scripture says, be anxious for nothing. And so they move so quickly. And I know that it's not God, because it's not done in excellence, because they haven't formed the right partnerships, because they don't have all the knowledge. And what happens is people will experience an instant success at their own hands, and then they will crash. And then when they crash, they feel like the Lord failed them. But it wasn't that the Lord failed them. It was that they launched way too soon. Like, they launched way too soon. And the Lord was saying, get the training, get the wisdom, get the knowledge, take some classes, go to school, be mentored, find these people that you need to connect to, because I'm telling you, it's in the partnership. Everybody has a part to bring to the vision. When we started this, I have a partnership. I have a partnership for this. I have somebody else working in this with me. I have partners who are building these things. One of the reasons sickle cell has not excelled at the level that it's supposed to, because I forgot about my partners. I had people that were a part of it, but I didn't bring to the table my partners. You know what I'm about to do? Bring to the table my partners and ask God to redeem the time. I'm just being real for y'all. So transition, because everybody's building vision boards. Everybody's getting ready to look for what's coming next. Everybody's putting forecasts for 2018. And I'm telling you, these are just the basics of what has to happen. You have got to get to your secret place. You have got to get in a position where you're before God. You're going to have some alone time. You're also going to have some time with your partners, the people that are connected to the vision. You're going to have time where you guys are at the table, having meetings, building, praying together, so that everybody is absolutely on one accord. This is even for the businesses that you're connected to. If you really want to excel, even at your job, even to be like, God is tired of Christians looking halfway and saying they're representing the kingdom. It's making the kingdom look schizophrenic. And the kingdom is not schizophrenic. We got all these Facebook posts, people talking about what God told them to do, and then they're doing something totally the opposite. Well, if the Lord set it in place and said to you, this is what you need to do, wait before you publicly broadcast. do the work behind the scenes, God will make your ta-da moment. Yes, Shanice Brown, including God in all things. I'm going to talk about that Thursday at Women of Faith, including God in all things. And backing up, the kingdom does not need to look schizophrenic. When we make the kingdom look schizophrenic for young converts, people who are new to Christ, it confuses them. And then you got them emotionally all over the place, because those of us that are supposed to be, right, wise, and those of us that are supposed to be in wisdom, right, are so not. And so the people that are watching our pages that are new to Christ don't understand how Christ operates, because those of us that are supposed to be so wise in the kingdom, we look schizophrenic before them. One minute we trust in God, one minute we not. One minute we cool with God, one minute we not. One minute we cussing somebody out on Facebook, one minute we not. One minute we telling them to exalt people, one minute we not. Those things are not of God. God, that's not God. If you having a schizophrenic moment, keep that to yourself. Because what's going to happen is somebody who's watching you, who is gleaming from you, who is using you as an example for the kingdom, is seeing what you have going on, and they're going to become confused. Have your schizophrenic moments, seasoned saints, in the privacy of your own house. I'm not telling you to be fake. You know I don't believe in that. What I'm saying is you have to watch what you do for the people that are watching you. You have to watch that. We got to watch that, because it's going to make the kingdom unstable. And when the kingdom gets unstable, it's hard for us to draw people in so we can draw people in. Everybody can't see all your transparency all the time. Y'all think I share everything with y'all. I don't. There are some things you will never know about me because the Lord hasn't released me to tell you. Because you ain't mature enough to handle that place in me. And I'm telling you, you're not mature enough. So you're going to have to, in this, pull to your secret place, pull to your private time, pull to your secret. Man, Shanice, bipolar experiences in the kingdom is making the kingdom look crazy. Lord told you to do something. You publicize it all over Facebook. Then 3 weeks later, you come back and you're like, oh, the Lord. No, baby. If the Lord told you to do something, it doesn't change. The promises of God are yes and amen. God is a God that he shall not lie. If the Lord made a promise to you, baby, he got to come through. He promised Abraham and Sarah that they were going to be the father of many nations. The problem came. Because they got ahead of God. She was so impatient. She didn't want to wait. She jumped off God's ship onto her own little boat and then created a rocky situation. Her little boat wasn't equipped to sail at the level that God's Titanic was created for. It was created for. She wasn't equipped. So she created a situation that caused another situation that was unnecessary. But the thing that I love about God is there always is a redemption. There's always a redemption. But can I tell you something? Some of y'all do not have to create a situation for a redemption to come. All you need to do is put yourself in a position and follow the instructions so that you can walk into what? Man, double-minded, therefore unstable, Roz. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. That's it. So, instructions for today. I told y'all we were moving into a season of instructions. He's going to start instructing us for what to do next. Get in your prayer closet, get in your personal prayer time, and expect a visitation for God. Ask for the Lord to visit you. Ask for the Holy Spirit to speak to you. You don't have to guess the things of God. Ask him. Sit down and say, Lord, show me in your word what you're trying to tell me for this next season in my life. God will speak to you. He will speak to you just like he speaks to me, and then he will provide confirmation for you. But don't run looking for confirmation. Sometimes people will get to every service, oh, prophesy to me. And the Lord is saying to you, I already showed this in your word. I already gave you a word for this. And then get yourself in a position to receive. Ask the Lord to speak and give you what you need for this next season. And he will. He has not failed yet. He talks to me all the time. But also sometimes he says stuff to me and I don't like it. Right? And so you got to be okay with what the Lord is going to say to you next. You got to be okay that if he says something to you that you're not necessarily comfortable with or that you like, you got to be okay with what he says to you next. You got to be okay with what he says to you next. So, secret place, prayer time, fasting before God, expecting a visitation. That's what you need to do. And get quiet. If the Lord gives you something, write it down. Pray and ask him who your partners are. Who's supposed to partner with me in this? Who's supposed to help tap into this? Who's supposed to be involved with this? What minute? Do y'all know something? I don't take every assignment that somebody comes and says, hey, can you do this? I am prayerful about what assignments, because there are some things that I've made a standard in my ministry, standard as a speaker, standard in my motivation, standard in who I'm supposed to connect to. He's going to give you the divine instructions for everything you absolutely need. God is real stable. I'm telling you, he is. God is a creature of habit. When he speaks things to you, it always comes with instructions. It always comes with provision. If you're doing something, right, and it doesn't seem like it's moving, pull back and ask the Lord, where have I missed it? Can I tell you something? This is going to be some big girl moves and big boy moves for some of y'all. Some of what you need is in the partnership. That's all the Lord has been speaking to me about. The reason that you're not being as successful as you could is because you don't have partnerships formed. You're afraid because you've been burned before. You're afraid because you've been burned before to create partnerships, to form alliances. And there are some divine alliances and partnerships that you're gonna have to form, even in your house, for this thing to be acceptable, where two or more agree. Agreement is the foundation of everything. So God is going to divinely align and pull some. I'm telling you, that's prophetic. It's in the partnership. What you need for what you need next is in your divine partnerships. The people that he's going to align, the people that are going to fund your projects, the people that are going to sow into your ministry, the people that are going to be the balance of what you have and what you need. It's in your divine partnerships. That's what needs to happen next. So pray. Yeah, make sure you keep a journal. Yeah, sometimes we're afraid because we fear the partner will finish that statement, Roz. We feel the partner will what? Run with our stuff? Or laugh at our stuff? It's so many different things. No, and I get the fear of it. I get the fear of the partnership outshine us. Ooh, Roz, don't make me throw my phone at this phone. Roz, you're right. You cannot be fearful because somebody's cup looks bigger than yours. I'm going to tell you something. The people connected to what LMJ Ministry does really outshines and makes LMJ do what she does. But because they're so secure in themselves, we're in partnership. I don't ever say this is my ministry. When we all at the table, this everybody ministry. And so you can't be afraid of who looks like they're in lead. You can't be afraid of who looks like they're in lead. Everybody is supposed to be duly connected to it. The Lord showed me some things about my husband that's to come, of what he would do in my ministry and where he was connected. And he would be somebody that really wouldn't want to be out in the forefront. And I'm cool with that. So I'm telling you, everything is connected to the lead. Everything is connected. Everything is connected, but it's in divine partnerships. That's it for today. Let me give you the confession. Can I tell you something? The Holy Ghost took that right over. He took that. The Holy Spirit took that right over. I wasn't even planning on going that way. So let me confess over you today. Today I'm confessing God's wisdom and perfect will. Can I tell y'all something? You keep struggling against the will of God because you feel like there's not enough wisdom for you in the Bible. There's all the wisdom that you need in the Bible. There's all the wisdom that you need in the Bible. There's all the wisdom that you need in the Holy Spirit. What you've got to do is pull in and get the partnerships in Christ, partnership in your relationship. Yeah, Chala, I'm releasing that out of my spirit today. That's prophetic. That was a rhema word for today. It's in your partnerships. Ask the Lord for your divine partnerships, because they're going to complement and supplement you in the areas in which you've been lacking and what you need. They're going to have the other part of the vision. And you got to be okay with them having the other part of the vision. And you got to listen to them. I don't know it all. And when I come to the table, all of my divine partners bring something so weighty to the table. It makes coffee and conversations. It makes pillow talk. It makes everything flow at such a capacity and level because of the divine partnerships. Let me confess. Father, I thank you that the communication of my faith becomes effectual by acknowledging every good thing which is in me in Christ Jesus. I hear the voice of the good shepherd. I hear my Father's voice, and the voice of a stranger I will not follow. Father, I believe in my heart and say with my mouth that this day the will of God is done in my life. I walk in a manner worthy of you, Lord, fully pleasing to you and designed to please you in all things, bearing fruit in every good work. Jesus has been made unto me wisdom. I singly, mindedly walk in that wisdom, expecting to know what to do in every situation and to be on top of every circumstance. I roll my works upon you, Lord, and you make my thoughts agreeable to your will. And so my plans are established and succeed. You direct my steps and make them sure. I understand and firmly grasp what the will of the Lord is, for I am not vague, thoughtless, or foolish. I stand firm and mature in spiritual growth, convinced and fully assured in everything willed by God. Father, you have destined and appointed me to come progressively to know your will. That is to perceive, to recognize more strongly and clearly, and to become better and more intimately acquainted with your will. I thank you, Father, for the Holy Spirit who abides permanently in me and who guides me in all truth, the whole full truth, and speaks whatever he hears from the Father and announces and declares to me the things that are to come. I have the mind of Christ and hold the thoughts, feelings, and purposes of his heart. So, Father, I have entered into the blessed rest by adhering, trusting, and relying on you in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen. I'm telling you, it's in the partnership. I'm telling you, divine partnerships. You got to be willing to walk into these partnerships. Once you tap into these partnerships, life is going to begin to explode for you. Things are going to move like never before. It's in these divine Can I tell you what I'm going to share this with you and I'm going to go. Divine partnerships form alliances. When you form alliances, it's hard for the enemy to get in. Divine partnerships form alliances. When you form alliances, it's hard for the enemy to get in. That's it. It's hard for him too, because the ranking is so tight. That's why all my partners I pray over. I don't let nobody say nothing to me about the people that are in my partnership. Now, we might get on each other within our partnership, but can't no outside person talk to me about anybody in my partnership. We got a tight rank. Why? Because we got to move, we got business, and we got work to do. So it's in your divine partnerships. So pray, get your journal. Hey, I'm going to release a journal today on lmjministryshop.com. I'm going to release a journal in just a little while. The journal will be 25% off if you want a new journal for the year. Don't forget to visit LMJ Ministry Shop. We got t-shirts, coffee mugs, other things that are coming. Everybody knows my t-shirt today says Girl Boss. Everybody knows how I am about t-shirts. Make sure December 7th you come and hang out with me Thursday. It's going to be really cool. Stories of empowerment and faith. Thank you, Hoop Love. I appreciate you so much. Thank you for encouraging me. It means absolutely everything. Hey, Saturday, Coffee and Conversations, we have a mystery guest. We have a mystery guest this Saturday. It is going to be quite the coffee and conversations. We'll drop the flyer for that tomorrow. So don't forget to invite someone in. to come in. Hey, if you're not saved, we're believing God for you. Like, we're believing God for your salvation. It's way more easier than you think. You need, and my other thing is, you gotta get connected to a local church. I have some amazing, my church in Pine Bluff is amazing. Agape Church here, I sat under their tutelage. My friends, Pastor Alfred and Roz Warren, Body of Christ Worship Center. I don't know a ministry more real than theirs. Do not, in this next season, don't go any further without being connected to a church, without being under somebody's ministry. My cousin, Pastor Travis, Stevie Travis Robinson, is at New Zion Grove Baptist Church. Like, I got ministers in my family. You looking for a church home? Get out there, feel your way. I'm telling you, Motivated Bishop in Jacksonville, if I endorse a church, it's because I know you're going to be at a good place. Get connected. Don't be without a covering. You're going to need it in this next season, because I'm telling you, the prophecies have been coming and what's about to happen next, you're going to be the need to be under a covering and connected to someone. I did not mean to take this long today. I love you guys so much. Let's get these instructions. Let's get our journals. Let's get our private prayer time together. Let's get our private prayer time together. Let's get before the Lord. Get the instructions. Meditate on the scriptures that I gave you today. I love you so, so much. Like, I love you more than you can imagine. So if you run into me, ask me for a Holy Ghost hug. I'll hug you. I love to hug. And go be loved today. Go love on someone. Let someone experience the love of Christ. See you back here in the morning for a Holy Spirit inspired time. Love, peace, and blessings.